Now that'll be here at 6:30 tonight. There will be a free will offering. That money will go to our new van to replace the van that is totaled out there. So that money tonight will go towards the new van. Tonight's just going to be a night of worship, a night of fun, just a time where we can just see some talented people sing and give their all for Christ. So that'll be tonight at 6:30. We do have youth today at 4 o'clock. So teenagers, make sure you're here at 4 o'clock and we'll have youth. And then it'll be over before the night of worship. So you guys can stay for that. Because I'm sure all the youth want to stay for that, right? Hallelujah. Just a few other fundraiser things. Our cookbook is on the press. I got it fixed up. We got everything done with it. We got it sent to the press. It is in the process. I just got the proofread copy emailed to me Friday, so I got to look at that and make sure it's good, and then I'll send it back this week. So hopefully we'll get it before Thanksgiving. The date they have is the week before Thanksgiving. So I have made up a order form. And I know people started signing up their name out there. These are for you guys to take home and take orders. Take them to your friends and families, your neighbors, whatever. And you can pre-sell the cookbooks. I guess we can leave one out there if anybody wants to sign up for it. But we ordered 300 cookbooks. Hallelujah. So we need people to sell cookbooks. They're $10. They're going to be $10 a piece. The more we ordered, the cheaper we got them for. So we tried to make it enough that we thought we could sell, but at the same time still make a decent amount of money doing this. So it's a great Christmas present, great thing to take to Thanksgiving and say, hey, we all get together and we have parties with 20 or 30 of our family members. So there's no reason you shouldn't sell 20 or 30 books at Thanksgiving each of you, right? That's what my thinking was when I ordered 300. But you can take those and pre-sell them. We can get those, raise money for the mission trip for that. What else we got here? Cantata practice starts this Thursday at 7 p.m. If you need it, your book and CD, Drew has those this morning. Do what? It started last Thursday. Did not know that. Well, I did. My wife was there. Wow. Cantata practice started last Thursday. It will continue this Thursday and every Thursday until Christmas. If you need your book, if you need your CD, Drew has those. Pick those up today. If you're in the cantata, and you can still join, you say? So if you still want to join, come on out. That's Thursdays at 7 p.m. Our ladies group, our women's Bible study, is going to be starting this Tuesday. And they did not meet last Tuesday, right? Okay, they are starting this Tuesday at 6:30. It's going to be here at the church normally, but this Tuesday is going to be up at Hometown Coffee. We're going to meet up there. Not weird. They're going to meet up there. They're going to meet just this first Tuesday at Hometown Coffee at 6:30. And then from then on, it'll be here at the church. Books are $13 if you'd like a book. I think Tina said she had about 20 books, but she can order more. She can order all we need. So see Tina, and she'll get you hooked up with that. Youth, I guess a little bit more youth news. Next Sunday, we're leaving here at 3 p.m. to go to Youth Invasion. That's in Kokomo. So we'll be leaving here next Sunday afternoon at 3 p.m. To go up to the Youth Invasion at Kokomo. The following Sunday, the 27th, 28th. 20, is that a Sunday, 27th? Okay, 27th. We're going to actually have youth. We're not going to have youth here. We're going to have youth at Joel and Tracy's house. They've agreed to host us. We're going to have a bonfire and devotions around the fire, some games and stuff like that, some food. So that'll be at 5 p.m. out at Joel and Tracy's house. We can give you the address if you need to know that. So that's the next two Sundays, the youth news. And then October 26th here at the church's Trunk or Treat. If you would love to be a part of that, we'd love for you guys to set up a trunk, set up something to give out. If you're afraid it's going to be too cold for you and you just don't do well, outside we'll have some area inside where we can make some popcorn and give away some candy and stuff in here. So if you just absolutely hate the cold and the thought of being outside just makes you cringe, we do have some areas in here for you guys to tell about it. If that's not your thing and you just are all not for it, but if you'd like to help, We do need candy donations. I think last year we gave out like 1,000 pieces of candy, and we ended up running out. So we need all the candy we can get to give to the kids. So if you'd like to bring candy and donate, there's a bin out under the table out there, and you can help out that way. And then I think Nelson has an announcement. We should have had like a music like dun 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 dun.
I appreciate it. Yeah, as a member of the MNO, really, I think we got a concern for one thing. You're not sure it's the 27th or the 28th. He wasn't sure when the choir was went someplace. So I don't know whether this is appropriate or not. you are in trouble. Yeah. I don't know if you know this or not, but this is October, I guess, is appreciation, past appreciation month.
Oh.
Yeah.
Did
you know that?
I saw it on Facebook.
Yeah. You're something. Could you come up, Kelly? So, yes, when I first got acquainted with these people, and it was before we interviewed them, Dean and I and them, we had dinner one evening. And to be around the people, it only takes like about 15 seconds. And it's like, these people are really unique. And something about them, I didn't know how unique you really were. But we had just a great time, and a number of the people, I think there was only two or three of us on the committee that did not know them prior. And Jody was one of them, and it's like, well, you know, we're going to go through this, all the checking of everything out, the credentials and everything, to try to make sure this is a thing. Well, it didn't take Jody long to realize that it would go far. And that's something that I realized meeting with them. And one of the questions we had was that calling, and she said they're a team. And in a past, like when you hire a pastor, it's like when you hire the pastor, you don't really hire a wife. This situation is a little different. We did hire a wife. I mean, she's their team, and you with them, you realize how they are. I mean, they're just amazing people, and you know their heart. And I believe they were hired for their heart, nothing else but their heart. And one of the pastors we never interviewed, but we had the resume was really impressive. I mean, he had a doctorate degree, he had done lots of things. I think he'd even worked with President Bush. Amazing. And so if you compared it to him, a little difference here. I told him both that we hired your heart, because your heart is where it's all at. And that you can say it's your heart, it's your soul, it's your spirit, it's your inner being, however you want to explain that. But what it is, it's the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is their motivation, and you're not around them very long until you realize that. You may not realize or remember what the message was about or what they say, but I tell you what you remember is the way they live. And they go out in the community. It's amazing what they do in the community. Just to walk in, there's something about them. And you know, God gets the glory for that. Not them, but they've allowed God to work through them. And so we are blessed that you answered the call to come here. And we look forward to meeting down through the years with you guys, the ministry here. And in our committee meetings we have with them, they are so great to work with. And I can be honest, I get carried away in our meetings sometimes. I really do. And I mean, I give everybody the fifth degree, but they are so kind and compassionate to work with. And we see, when we look at you, we see God working in you, and we greatly appreciate it. So just appreciation, we've given you some certificates, and we really love you. God loves you, and we just hope the best for you. Thanks.
Thank you. Well, thank you so much. Kelly and I are humbled and still in awe that God chose us to be here. And we're thankful for you guys and how much you guys have accepted us. And I'm going to start crying because I didn't expect that. I thought you were going to make a children's church announcement. But thank you. Thank you from the bottom of our hearts. It's an honor and privilege to be here and serve you guys. Especially Joel. I think Joel's one of the reasons the Lord brought me here, because he needs some work. I'm just joking, brother. We got a couple other announcements. This handed to me this morning. There has been a house fire. Debbie and Gary Kelsey in Winchester, but I'm guessing they lost everything. They lost everything, okay. Including what? Holy cow, $7. So just some info, if anybody would have things that they could donate. Gary wears a size 38-30 pants and a size large shirt. Debbie, size 14 pants and large shirt. So if anybody would like to donate those things, if you got some extra stuff sitting around, I think I have some 38-30 pants that I haven't worn in about 10 years. So I might be able to dig those out. But if you want to bring those here, we can be a point where if you guys want to bring them in, we can make sure that it gets to them. It says that household items will be needed at a later point, but they don't need those things right now. They just are kind of in need of clothes to wear. So if anybody's interested in donating to that, you can just bring it here to the church, and we will get it to them. And then if the ushers want to come forward for morning tithes and offerings, just a few prayer requests. Carrie Burge had a little episode this morning, and we're not sure what it was, but she did go home, and she promised if it happened again, she would go to the hospital. We kind of was hoping she would go to the hospital, but she chose not to, so be in prayer for her. Jeremy Pollock, of course, is continuing his battle with colon cancer. He had some chemo this past week, and he's kind of sick, not feeling well, so he's not here today. And then Sharon's sister, Donna, has been struggling with cancer, and Devin Lowdy, and also Jimmy Coe, which is Paul's brother, has been battling some stuff, so we need to pray for them. And also Don Young, is he still in the hospital, or is he's home? Okay, doing well. Okay, so Don's doing better. We'll keep praying for him, and of course Dave Welsh. And then I heard Dorothy Berry, she hasn't been feeling real well, not doing real well, so keep praying your prayers. And then also we got a prayer request this morning for a fellow that has just found out this week that he has lung cancer. So be praying for that fellow. So let's just come before the Lord. God, we thank you so much for this day. God, we thank you that you love us and that you are for us. God, and we just pray, Lord, as we look at these prayer requests and we think about how blessed we are, Father, and how much you have touched us, how much you've given us, Father, but there are those who are hurting, those who are sick, Father. We just pray that you would just touch those situations. Lord, we know, Father, that you are the good physician, that you can do things that are beyond our comprehension. And we just pray, Father, that power of your Holy Spirit would just touch these people right now, God, and that you would just touch their bodies. We pray, Father, for the service this morning. We pray, God, that you would have your way in everything that we do and say, God, that it would bring you the glory this morning. In your precious name, we pray.
Thank you. worship, and all of our kiddos, preschool through sixth grade, can go on downstairs. I said preschool through sixth grade. All adults come back in, bidding after the service, please. Thank you.
Thank you. We bless your name. Not just because you're always good to us, but Father, you're always there for us. You are always good. But good, our lives aren't always great. That doesn't mean that you've left. It doesn't mean that you've abandoned us. That means you're trying to do things in us and through us. Father, we know that we can lean on you. Whether you're giving or you're taking away, you're still God. Your intentions are so good for us. Thank you.
chase after us, desire us. That is so powerful. Thank you for being our good, good Father, our Creator, that designed us with a purpose. Jesus, we love you, and we worship you.
Really, the last few weeks we've been looking at the book of Philippians, kind of going through it, and but last week we started on chapter 3, I don't know, to me that was really fascinating, to see Paul, talk about his pedigree and his ancestry and all this stuff that made him perfect in the eyes of the world, and we saw how if anyone could ever stand before God based on religion and how perfect they were in religion's eyes, it was Paul. But he looked at those things differently. And all these things that he had did before he met Christ to earn perfection, to earn righteousness and faultlessness. Paul says when he met Christ, all those things became a loss. I thought, man, that's a huge statement, a loss. And Paul said not only are they a loss, they're so useless that he called, I'm sure you remember, but he used this word scubulon, or dung. Paul says it's all garbage, it's all dung compared to knowing Christ and having this relationship with him. And, knowing Christ was more important than anything else to Paul. We need to make sure that it's the most important thing to us too. But when I read things like that, and I read that Paul's, that amazing revelation and truth, and look at how Paul was, considered earthly accomplishments a loss and rubbish, I think, man, Paul has this thing figured out. He's met Christ, and he's this, even when he says all these earthly things that showed that he was perfect and righteous are wrong, I still look at him and think, man, he must have been the perfect guy. He must have been perfect. He's arrived at Christian maturity, and he's given up everything for the sake of Christ, and God used him. Think about that. God used him to record Scripture. How morally righteous do you need to be for God to use you to write, 2/3 of the New Testament? And in my opinion, aside from Jesus, Paul is probably one of the greatest men in the history of our known, recorded history. To ever walk on the face of this earth. But look what Paul says after he goes through all of that, and after he says all these things are lost for knowing Christ, he goes on in Philippians 3:12, the first sentence, he says, not that I have already attained all this or arrived at my goal. So Paul says, I'm not there yet. He claims, that he hasn't achieved the spiritual maturity that we're working towards. And he knew there was room for improvement. So Paul had this decision to make. And, sometimes it's easy when things, when we can't quite achieve something or can't quite attain something, it's easy just to get discouraged and give up. I kind of think of that, when I think about my diet. Have you guys ever been on a diet and you're doing great for 2 or 3 weeks and you lose 15 or 20 pounds and all of a sudden, is that outrageous? Oh, sorry. Anyway. But then, you come and you have a bakery, a baked auction, or, something happens, you have a monthly meeting, and you think, oh, one meal won't hurt. And next thing you know, you're in a three-day downfall, where you've been stuffing your face, and in 3 days, you gained all the weight that it took you 3 weeks to lose. That's discouraging, and you just want to give in the towel. Hopefully your diets aren't like that, but mine are. I think in the last 6 weeks, I've lost almost 50 pounds in the last 6 weeks. And I've gained 39. So I'm 11 pounds to the good. But if I would have just kept going and not gained those 39s, I don't know what would happen. But anyway, it's easy to get discouraged. My point is, when you hit a wall or you say, I'm never going to get there. And if we look at Paul's life, he could have given up a whole lot. I mean, he was in prison all the time. He was beaten in public all the time. He was falsely accused all the time. And you know how easy it would have been for him to just say, you know what, I met Christ, I'm a Christian, I'm just going to go home. I want to serve Christ in the comfort of my own home. I want to stop going to the temple to preach. I want to stop going to the street to try to convert people to, give them the good news. I'm just going to go home and serve God in my own comfort of my own house. He would have had a perfect life. I mean, that's all the religious people wanted. That's all the Jews wanted for him, just to quit preaching. But Paul didn't. You see, he did what was right instead of what was comfortable. So instead of getting discouraged, Paul let this opposition motivate him, and it gave him a drive and a determination to keep fighting, to keep pressing on. And that's actually what he said in the second part of Philippians 3:12. He says, not that I've already obtained all this or have arrived at my goal, but I press on to take the hold of that which Christ Jesus has took hold of me. Paul says, it's not that I've already obtained this perfection. I haven't made it there yet, but I'm driving towards it. I'm working towards it. I'm pressing on. I'm throwing the garbage aside. I'm getting rid of the dung, the things that don't matter, and I'm taking hold of Jesus. And listen how Paul, he was encouraged, even when things weren't perfect, even things when things weren't smooth and comfortable around him. Look what he says in the next two verses, in verses 13 and 14. He says, brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself to have yet taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining towards what is ahead, I press on towards the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. And as we read this, we can get this idea, and Paul uses this analogy a lot, that we're in this race. Life is a race, and we're running after this prize. Unfortunately, a lot of times in life, we get caught up in the rat race. Everybody heard of the rat race? They've actually defined that. I didn't know that was actually, I just thought that was a slang term, but I looked it up. And there's actually a definition in the dictionary. It said, and the rat race is an endless, self-defeating, and pointless pursuit. And the term rat race is usually associated with an exhausting, repetitive lifestyle that leaves no room for rest, relaxation, or enjoyment. Man, I've been there. I've been in the rat race before. And it's kind of like this idea of this rat that goes through a maze, and somewhere in this maze, towards the end of it, there's this little insignificant crumb of cheese. But this rat is frantically going through the maze trying to find it. And the reward is just not worth the struggle that it goes through. In a newspaper called The Daily Leader, it gives the signs that you're caught in a rat race. And I have a slide for it that has these signs. The first one is you're unhappy. You live in the past. You give up hope that things will get better. You lack purpose. Your health suffers. You feel powerless to change. You become negative. Your view of the future looks grim and bleak. These are the signs of the rat race. And when we're in this rat race and we live our lives in pursuit of some little insignificant reward, it wears us down and we can get defeated. But Paul says in verse 14 that we're not running for an insignificant prize. We're running for this prize that's not temporary, but it's eternal. This prize of Jesus Christ, this prize of relationship with Him that lasts for eternity. That's the prize. And when we chase after that prize, when we go after that, there aren't any negative side effects. And it's awesome. Look at this. The rat race says that if you're caught up in the rat race, we're unhappy. But when we race to God's presence, 1 Peter 1:8 and 9 says, though you have not seen Him, you love Him. Even though you do not see Him now, you believe in Him, and you're filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. For you are receiving the end result of your faith, the salvation of your souls. So, man, do I want to be unhappy, or do I want to be filled with inexpressible and glorious joy? I mean, one of those sounds a whole lot better than the other. The rat race says that you live in the past, but in our race towards God, Jeremiah 29:11 says, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not harm you, to give you hope and a future. That sounds a whole lot better. In the rat race, we give up hope. But in our race to Jesus, Romans 15:13 says, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in Him, so that you may overflow with hope in the power of the Holy Spirit. In the rat race, we lack purpose, but Proverbs 19:21 says, many are the plans of a person's heart, but it is the Lord's purpose that prevails. In the rat race, our health suffers, but Isaiah 53:5 says, by His wounds we are healed. And I don't know about you, but the side effects that come with chasing after Jesus sound a whole lot better than the sound effects of living in this world and trying to find that minute, insignificant prize that the world has to offer. When we're running after Jesus, when our eyes are on Him, when we're running after His presence, the prize we receive is satisfying. It's fulfilling and it's eternal. And Paul tells us to keep our eyes on that prize. That's the prize we need to focus on. That's the prize that we don't want to look around. We don't want to look back. We want to look forward, strain towards that prize. Never quit. Keep focusing and looking ahead. And in our scripture this morning, that's exactly what Paul's telling us to do in our walk with Christ. He's telling us that we can't be passive. We can't just stand still and live life. There's no just living life. We're either pressing on towards God. We're either going after Him or we're focused on something else. There's no in between. I mean, you're either moving forward or you're not. We have to press on towards the goal that God has for each of us. And in the Greek, this word press on, or this phrase press on, actually means to pursue or to run quickly or to run swiftly or strain after something. So to press on, it's not just an idea of we're taking a nice little walk. We're pressing, we're straining, we're pursuing God's presence. There's nothing in the idea of pressing on that tells us to relax and stand still. So how do we do that? How do we keep on pressing on? If we look in these verses today, I believe Paul gives us three things that we can do on our chase to Jesus and the reward that He has for us. The first thing, we have to make God's goals our goals. Philippians 3:12, not that I've already obtained all this or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that which Christ Jesus took hold of me. So if we're going to press on towards the goals that God has for us, we have to make His goals our goals. You know, it's all right to have our own goals in life, but His goals are where the prize is. His goals are what we need to work towards. And we can't work towards a goal if we don't know where we're at. If you think about that, everybody's used a GPS, right? I'm sure most people have. No, I see some head nods, shaking those. But if you use a GPS, does it help just to put in the address of where you want to go? No. Because it don't know where you're at. The GPS doesn't know where you're at. It can't give you directions if it doesn't know where you're starting from. You know, if I'm telling somebody to go to Indianapolis, you know, I can't just tell them how to get there. Because I don't know where they're at. They could be here, they could be in Cincinnati, they could be in Terre Haute, they could be in Chicago. I can't tell them how to get to Indianapolis. See, we have to know where we're at. We have to be honest to where we're at. And Paul was honest to where he was in this pursuit of Christ. In verse 12, he says, I've not obtained these things. I'm going to be honest. I'm not perfect. I've not obtained these things that I need to do. And Paul realizes he has a way to go. And he shares that honesty in these verses. And you know, how many times do we struggle in our walk with Christ and we hide it and we come to church and we smile and we act like we have it all together. And we look at somebody and we say, man, I hope they don't know what I'm going through. It'd be so embarrassing. I don't, they look like they have it all put together. And I don't want them to think that I don't. And I'm going to go on a limb and I'm going to say that they're probably thinking the same thing. Because none of us are perfect. I know my wife would say I'm not. And I'm pretty sure you don't laugh because your wives say you aren't. And your husbands say you aren't. But man, we think we have this idea that we look at people, we think they got things figured out. They're where they're supposed to be. And man, they're thinking the same thing. They're thinking, man, I messed up this week. What am I going to do? And we got to realize that none of us are perfect. I guarantee if Paul's not perfect, I'm not perfect. Because Paul's a whole lot better man than I was. Man, none of us have this thing worked out. None of us have it figured out. So we have to be honest where we are in our walk with Christ. We have to be honest where we are and when we look at God's goals. Because we can't get to where He wants us to be until we're honest with where we're at now. Second thing that we can do to press on towards Christ is to always keep a forward focus. The next verse in 13:14 says, brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself to have yet taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining towards what is ahead, I press on towards the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. Has anyone ever tried to run, like, straight and look behind you? I challenge you to try that. Go out, find an open field or a big yard, because if you don't, you're going to hit something. And just take off in a dead sprint, and then just turn your head around. run that way. I guarantee you're not going to know where you're going. You're going to veer off. It'd be hilarious, actually. Maybe we ought to do that. We all should just go out in the parking lot. No. But, you know, I think of this a lot. You know, I don't watch a lot of horror movies, but, you know, the horror movies, they always do that, you know. They always run looking behind them. You know, if something's chasing me, I'm gone. I'm not going to be looking for the chainsaw guy. I'm gonna be running. You can't run very well if you're turned around looking up behind you. You can't drive your car safely if you're staring in the rearview mirror. Try that. Well, no, don't try that. Don't try that. Sorry, Brad. I hope there's not an influx of wrecks this afternoon on the way from church. But the first thing that Paul says is get rid of distractions. In verse 13, Paul says, but one thing I do. He doesn't say there's a bunch of things I got to do to get this right. He says, one thing I do. He was able to narrow his focus to one thing and putting everything behind him. There's one thing that I do. Hebrews 12 says to throw off anything that distracts us, anything that hinders our race, throw it off. Have you ever noticed that the more you have going on, the harder it is to focus on any of it? I know the last month or so, a couple months, we've had a lot of stuff going on that week more. We had the fall festival. We had the party at the pond. We had some other things going on in our life. My dad in the hospital, and other things, just running church as usual. You know, and I know that I would start this thing, and then I would go over and start this thing, and go to the third thing, and back to the first thing, and it was hard to focus on any of it. But man, when I only have one thing to do, man, I got laser focus. I can get that done. I can accomplish it and move on instead of just hopping around. We have to go get one thing. You know, a lot of what we do is necessary in life. I understand that. You know, and they're good and productive. But I also know there's a lot of distractions in life. There's a lot of things that weigh us down and hold us back that are just as easy to throw off. And Paul said to get rid of those things, get rid of those distractions. There's an interesting story that I saw in the 1954 British Games in Vancouver. There were two runners. They were the first two runners to break the four-minute mile. I'm not a runner, so that doesn't mean much to me, but that's a big thing, I guess. And for one of the first times, these guys are going to be running together. Naked, they're going to be running in the same race, in the same mile race in the 54 British Games. Their names were Roger Bannister and John Landy. And they took off in this race, and they were neck and neck. And they turned the last corner to finish the race. And Landy was a step ahead of Bannister. And Landy, he made the biggest mistake he could make. And you can see it in this picture, the guy on the right, you can see him turn around. Because he knew he was ahead of Bannister, but he turned around for a split second to see where he was, to see how far ahead he was. And as soon as he turned around, the other guy passed him on the right and won the race by 8/10 of a second. All because he turned around and took that split second to look. And it was actually such a huge blunder. The picture on the right is actually a statue outside the stadium that they made of the dude looking back as the guy passed him. Man, we can't look back. When we look back to see what we've done, it affects where we're going. Even for a split second. Some people glory in their past victories. You know, they're happy to relive those past victories. And instead of seeing God and pursuing Him now and thinking, man, what does God want to do now in my life? They're just happy to take comfort in what God's already done. And man, don't get me wrong, I love hearing those stories. I love hearing victories in the past and what God has done. But man, I want to press on. I want to see what God wants to do now. I want to see what He wants to do now in our present circumstances. And of course, there's people on the other side of that spectrum that all they can focus on are not victories, but defeats and failures. And they look back and think, man, I've blown it. I've failed. And that's all they can focus on. And they think, there's no way that God could use me because of how much I've messed up. And they focus on all this in the back, and they think they've made too many mistakes for God to ever be able to use them. And man, I want to tell you this morning, that's a lie from the devil himself. If we confess our sins, and then, you know, God is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness, we can move forward. We can move ahead. And not only has God forgiven us, He wants to use us, and He has a job for us to do. So we can't just sit and look at our past failures and think God could never use us. We got to press on towards what God has now. Press on towards the goal. Persevere. Keep going. Keep straining forward. Keep running. Keep our eyes on the prize. We can't quit. We got to keep going. Remember why you're running the race. Remember that there's a goal. Remember that the goal is not insignificant. We're running to see Jesus. Man, what a prize. What a prize to see Jesus face to face. So the first thing, we have to make God's goals our goals. The second thing, we have to keep a forward focus at all times. And the third thing is we can't ever lose ground in our walk with Christ. In verses 15 and 16, Paul says, all of us then who are mature should take such a view of things. And if on some point you think differently, that too God will make clear to you. Only let us live up to what we have already attained. So there's two things in this verse. The first thing, it's interesting that Paul uses this word mature here. He says, you who are mature, take view of such things. If you go back to the Greek, it's actually the same word that Paul said earlier for perfect. So Paul's saying, I'm not perfect, but in my perfection, I need to keep going forward. You look at that and you think, man, that doesn't really make sense. You know, Paul's saying, I'm not yet reached perfection yet. So all of us that are perfect should take a view of these things. And I think what he's saying is those who are pressing on towards God, those who are going after Jesus, those who are striving for the goal of eternity with Jesus, they know they haven't arrived yet. That's part of being a mature Christian. That you know you're not there yet. You know that in all our victories and everything that God's done in us and through us, that man, we're not there. There's a story of a musician who was talking to another musician. One of them, they just had a concert, and the other guy said, did you record it? And then the guy said, yeah, we recorded it. It was great. And the second guy said, did you listen back to it? And the guy, the first one said, yeah, I did. And the guy said, were you happy with it? And the first guy said, it was great. I loved it. It was the best. And the guy said, then you'll never grow. He said, you'll never get better if you think that was your best. Man, we got to keep striving. Mature believers in Christ know that they're not perfect. They know that we have room to grow. Like Joyce Meyer says, I may not be where I used to be, but thank God. I may not be where I want to be, but thank God I'm not where I used to be. Paul says, if you're a mature believer, you're going to realize that you're not perfect yet. The second thing that Paul says is that he makes sure that you live up to what you've already attained. And we pointed this out earlier. Paul says, keep moving forwards. Don't go backwards. There's no room to go backwards. You know, if we're focused on Christ, we've got to keep moving. We have to live up to what we already attained and keep moving forward and keep gaining ground. Don't lose it. Because we don't want to fall back. You know, we have to make sure that we're all, you know, even though we're all at different points in our life and our Christian life and our walk with God, we have to make sure that we're living up to what we've already attained. We have to make sure that right now we're the farthest that we've been, because we don't want ever go backwards. So Paul says to keep moving. He says run your race with your eye on the prize. And to do that, we make God's goals your goals. Make sure that no matter what, keep your focus ahead. Keep straining forward. Don't worry about what's on behind you. Don't turn around and look, but keep going forward. And the third thing is to never lose our ground in our walk with Jesus. Always make sure that you're at the farthest point that you've ever been. See, the Christian life is a race, and really there's only three reasons we're not racing it this morning. The first reason is that you finished your race. And if you have, that's scary, because that means you're dead. And you're in heaven, so you wouldn't be here this morning. So we can rule that one out. There's no one here like that, right? Everybody here is alive and kicking. Hallelujah. The second reason is that maybe you never started. Maybe you've never accepted Christ as your Savior. Man, there's no better time than today. He is here and he's waiting. His forgiveness is immediate and free. And it comes with indescribable glory and joy. And I hope that that's you today, that you make Jesus your Savior. And the third thing is maybe you started your race, but somewhere along the line you stopped running. Somewhere along the line, maybe you look back. Maybe you went home to relax or whatever. But I challenge you, if that's you today, don't sit on the sidelines. Strain forward. Go after Jesus and see what he has for your life. So as we close in prayer, of course, our altars are always open. If you guys would like to come up, we would love to pray with you guys. So let's just bow our heads. Father, we thank you, Lord, for your word. We thank you, God, that we can see Paul as an example, and we can understand, Father, through his life and his example, that we need to move forward. God, always straining and striving, Father, to go after what you have for us. God, and we know, Father, that that's not some insignificant prize. God, we're not just chasing after some puny little thing that gives us temporary joy, Father, but the prize we're gaining, the prize we're striving after is you, Father, to see you face to face, to spend eternity with you, Father. Oh, man, what a prize. How awesome on that day to stand in your presence and hear you say, well done, my good and faithful servant. God, that's what we're striving for. And I pray today, Father, that if there is anybody here that has not made that decision to know you, Father, I pray that you would just tug on their hearts this morning, God, and they give you your life, their life. We love you and thank you, Lord, and we pray all this in your name. Amen.
Would you please stand as we close in worship?
Let them be glory.
pray for those here that feel like they're stuck in a rat race. And Father, you would help them to see that the prize is amazing, that it's worth it. And Father, you have come to take away our unhappiness, to give us a break.